On the 29th of April 2025, Firefly Aerospace launched its 6th Alpha rocket flight from Vandenberg Space Force Base in California. For the first 2.5 minutes, the rocket appeared to be operating normally. However, at stage separation, onboard video revealed an unusual cloud of white fumes or vapour. Despite the stages separating successfully and the second stage engine igniting, a closer look at the footage showed a critical issue. The second stage engine's exhaust nozzle was missing. Comparisons with previous missions confirmed that an anomaly during or around stage separation likely caused the nozzle's loss. Post-flight analysis revealed the severity of the problem. The second stage, carrying Lockheed Martin's LM-400 satellite payload, failed to reach orbit and crashed into the ocean. An update from Firefly confirmed the failure of the flight. The rocket experienced a mishap between stage separation and second stage ignition that led to the loss of the lightning engine nozzle extension, substantially reducing the engine's thrust. The stage and payload have now safely impacted the Pacific Ocean in a cleared zone north of Antarctica. The FAA will hold an accident investigation to determine the root cause of the failure. Regardless of the exact reason, it's a bad situation that will cause potential customers to reconsider if the Alpha launch vehicle is a suitable option for their payloads. Firefly's mixed record. Firefly Aerospace's Alpha rocket, capable of lifting 1,000 kilos or 2,200 pounds to low Earth orbit, occupies a mid-tier niche between small satellite launchers like Rocket Lab's Electron and medium lift vehicles such as SpaceX's Falcon 9. However, with 6 launches completed by April 2025, Alpha's reliability remains inconsistent, raising concerns for potential customers. A Firefly customer will have a 1 in 3 chance of success, a 1 in 3 chance of partial success, and a 1 in 3 chance of failure. Those odds are not good. High insurance costs, driven by Firefly Alpha's inconsistent track record, make securing launch contracts challenging, especially given more reliable launchers such as Rocket Lab for small payloads and SpaceX for heavier payloads exist. Alpha's payload capacity positions it between Electron at 300 kilos and medium lift vehicles like Falcon 9, United Launch Alliance's Vulcan Centaur, Blue Origin's New Glenn, and Europe's Ariane 6, all of which have flown successfully at least once. This no-man's land niche, as Rocket Lab's CEO Peter Beck describes it, struggles to attract customers needing either small, cost-effective launches or large-scale rideshares. In the US, ABL pivoted away from launch vehicles into the defense sector. The only other US startup possibly in the same class is Stoke Space, with a maximum payload of 1,650 kilos. Still, their vehicle is reusable, so it's likely to have lower launch costs or a higher profit margin than Firefly. There are quite a few European and Asian launch providers entering this mid-tier market. For instance, ISAR Aerospace launched from Norway recently. Although not successful, they have the hardware for a second and third vehicle soon. Rocket Factory Augsburg from Germany and PLD Space from Spain could be launching later this year or early next year. Their vehicles are capable of launching around 1,000 kilos or more into orbit. Asia has a few startups. Interstellar Technologies from Japan is developing their Zero rocket that can lift 1,000 kilos into orbit. And from South Korea, Innospace has the Hanbit family of rockets, the largest of which falls into the same category as Firefly's Alpha vehicle. Firefly has flown one commercial customer so far, Lockheed Martin. I'm not counting the CubeSat payloads on the first two missions as serious commercial launches. Their payloads flew on Flight 4 and Flight 6. Flight 4 was a partial failure or partial success, depending on your point of view. A software error caused the payload to be released into the wrong orbit, but the payload was still able to function, so not a complete loss. However, in the recent flight, the LM-400 tech demo for Lockheed Martin was a complete loss and ended up in the Pacific Ocean shortly after launch. Alpha's only full successes have been for government clients, while commercial payloads have faced issues or outright failure, limiting Firefly's appeal to private customers. Firefly hasn't established a reliable track record. Firefly is one of just a handful of active US launch companies with rockets that have reached low Earth orbit, but its Alpha rocket hasn't established a reliable track record. In 6 flights, Alpha has amassed just 2 unqualified successes. How long can Firefly continue to operate with a launch vehicle that is not reliable? What is the historical precedent for unreliable launches? How long can they continue to operate before going out of business, pivoting to other services, or establishing their vehicle as reliable? Two other US commercial companies come to mind that we can use as examples, SpaceX and Astra. SpaceX almost went bankrupt as the first three vehicles all failed. It succeeded on the fourth attempt and the rest is history. Astra has multiple failures before achieving orbit in 2021, and it continues today due to investor support, though its long-term success is far from certain. In the end, Firefly must produce reliable launchers that consistently and routinely place customer payloads into orbit in the correct orbits, or pivot to other services or cease to operate. It's not clear yet which way Firefly will go. Bigger than Electron, smaller than SpaceX, niche, no man's land. Firefly Aerospace positions its Alpha rocket as a unique solution for satellites too large for Rocket Lab's Electron, but too small to justify a dedicated SpaceX Falcon 9 launch. With a payload capacity of 1,030 kilos to low Earth orbit, Alpha targets this middle ground. The company has secured notable contracts, including two payloads for Lockheed Martin. Several commercial customers have also booked slots, giving Firefly the fourth largest confirmed launch backlog among US providers, trailing only SpaceX, United Launch Alliance, and Rocket Lab. However, Alpha's $15 million price tag, double Electron's $7.5 million, combined with higher insurance costs due to its low reliability, tarnishes its market appeal. The recent Flight 6 failure has amplified these concerns. Sir Peter Beck, Rocket Lab's CEO, argues Alpha occupies a no-man's land, too small for efficient rideshare missions, and too costly for dedicated small-sat launches. Insurance costs amplifies Alpha's challenges. Launch insurance, a critical factor in customer decisions, reflects a rocket's risk profile. Electron's 94% success rate, 63 out of 67 launches by April 2025, keeps insurance costs low, typically 5 to 10% of a payload's value. For a $10 million satellite, Electron's total cost, including $7.5 million for the launch and $500,000 to $1 million in insurance, ranges from $8 to $8.5 million. Alpha's mixed record drives insurance costs higher, likely 15 to 20% of payload value. For the same $10 million satellite, Alpha's $15 million launch cost plus $1.5 to $2 million in insurance costs, results in a total of $16.5 to $17 million, nearly double Electron's price. High-value payload customers, sensitive to these costs, may hesitate to choose Alpha over Electron's proven reliability. Can Alpha's niche attract customers? Alpha's larger capacity suits payloads between 500 to 1,000 kilos, offering a cost-effective alternative to Falcon 9 for specific missions. Customers like the US Department of Defense and NASA, with budgets to support commercial launch development, value Alpha's niche. These agencies prioritize boosting competition to drive down long-term costs, making them less sensitive to Alpha's price and risk. Firefly's contracts with these entities and Lockheed Martin demonstrate demand for this middle ground. However, price-sensitive commercial customers may hesitate at Alpha's costs, especially when Electron delivers reliable, frequent launches for smaller satellites at a lower price. Beck's critique highlights Alpha's dilemma. It lacks the capacity for efficient rideshares like Falcon 9 and is too expensive for dedicated smallsat missions compared to Electron. The shift towards medium lift vehicles. The launch industry increasingly favors medium launch vehicles for deploying large satellite constellations. Vehicles like SpaceX's Falcon 9, Blue Origin's New Glenn, ULA's Vulcan Centaur, Rocket Lab's upcoming Neutron, and Europe's Ariane 6 are well suited for mega constellations such as Amazon's Kuiper or Europe's Iris 2. The case for pivoting to a medium launch vehicle. Is Firefly's niche financially viable, or should the company pivot to a larger MLV as Relativity Space did, or focus on alternative services like lunar landers and orbital tugs? While Firefly continues flying the Alpha rocket, its engineers are developing a larger medium launch vehicle in partnership with Northrop Grumman. Relativity Space pivot from Terran 1 to Terran R a 20-ton to LEO vehicle, sets a precedent. Recognizing the crowded small launch market and growing need for medium to heavy lift, relativity shifted to compete with SpaceX. Firefly faces the same pressures. The small launch market, dominated by Rocket Lab's reliable Electron, with a 94% success rate, limits Alpha's growth. Larger payloads and rideshares, driven by mega constellations, favor MLVs like Falcon 9, Blue Origin's New Glenn, ULA's Vulcan Center, and Rocket Lab's upcoming Neutron. Firefly has already partnered with Northrop Grumman to develop an MLV, possibly named Antares 330, with a projected capacity of 8 to 10 tons to LEO. This partnership leverages Firefly's propulsion technology and Northrop's manufacturing expertise. A pivot to an MLV could position Firefly to compete for high-value contracts, not only constellations but also national security payloads, which can be lucrative and are limited exclusively to US companies. The Flight 6 failure underscores the urgency of proving reliability, whether with Alpha or a future MLV. If Firefly can't carve out a sustainable mid-tier segment, shifting focus to a larger vehicle may be inevitable. The Flight 6 failure may erode customer confidence, critical in the launch industry. Market trends are moving away from smaller launches, suggesting Alpha's niche could shrink. There is no point in going smaller, Rocket Lab owns that market. So either Firefly goes bigger, or it pivots to other services. Pivoting to lunar landers and orbital tugs. Firefly could also pivot to providing lunar landers and orbital space tugs. In March 2025, Firefly celebrated a major accomplishment with the first fully successful landing on the moon by a private US company. NASA has contracted 3 Blue Ghost lunar lander missions from Firefly. The company received $101.5 million from NASA for the first mission, which was a huge success. The value of the second mission hasn't been disclosed, but the third mission is worth $179.6 million. In addition, a commercial lunar payload service task order was placed for Firefly's Electra-Dark space tug. These contracts highlight Firefly's growing expertise in cislunar operations, offering a potential pivot away from the competitive launch market. What do you think? Should Firefly continue in its precarious mid-tier market? Or should it go for broke with a larger vehicle or pivot to other services? Leave your thoughts in the comments section below. Okay, that's a wrap. Thanks for watching. A quick note, Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you're watching from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, cover any missed news, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.